He has 84 degrees. He's in Orlando, and he has expected high of 91 with scattered thunder showers throughout the day, and I look throughout the week, and it's going to be in the upper 80s and 90s there with scattered thunder showers most of the day. They're going to Disney World. So I recall going to Disney World in August about 8-9 years ago, and getting drenched often during the month of August. So, No, it's not. No. The best part of that vacation was my son-in-law was carrying an insulated backpack with ice and bottles of water, and he bent down to tie his shoe, and all the ice water spilled. He says, after I got over the shock, he says, it was really great. So we pray that Angel and his family have a great time at Disney World, and the weather cooperates so that they can enjoy that. Are there other announcements for the good of us that we need to share with one another? All right. So let us turn then to the call to worship. If you can stand, please do so. If it's a difficulty, please remain seated. I will bless the Lord at all times. God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt God's name together. Look to God and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed.
The poor cry out, and the Lord heard, and saved them out of all their troubles.
The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear God and delivers them.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in God.
Let us join in our first song, Cry of My Heart.
Join me in the morning prayer, please.
O Holy God, open unto me light for my darkness, courage for my fear, hope for my despair. O living God, open unto me wisdom for my confusion, forgiveness for my sins, love for my hate. O God of peace, open unto me peace for my turmoil, joy for my sorrow, strength for my weakness. O generous God, open my heart to receive all your gifts. Amen. Our first lesson is 1 Kings, chapter 19, verses 4 through 8. But Elijah himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a solitary broom tree. He asked that he might die. It is enough now, O Lord. Take away my life, for I am no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under the broom tree and fell asleep. Suddenly an angel touched him and said to him, "Get up and eat." He looked, and there at his head was a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. He ate and drank and laid down again. The angel of the Lord came a second time, touched him and said, "Get up and eat, otherwise the journey will be too much for you." He got up and ate and drank. Then he went in the strength of that food for 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mount of God. The word of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Chapter 6, verses 35, 41 through 51. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Then the Jews began to complain about him because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." They were saying, "Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Jesus answered them, "Do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me, and I will raise that person up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, 'And they shall all be taught by God.' Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father and except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh.
Before I begin my message, I wanted to thank Abby for filling in. Her mom's away, and so she's subbing in as our worship leader. Glad to have you with us. Sorry for not mentioning that earlier. And as you know, I like to start with something humorous usually. Today is no exception. A Sunday school teacher asked, "How many of you children would like to go to heaven?" All of them raised their hands except Ronnie. The teacher asked him, "Why not?" "I'm sorry," Ronnie replied. "Mommy told me to come right home after Sunday school." So you may have gotten orders to come right home after church. And then there's a story about a man who came into Delavan, and he approached one of the locals and said, "What's the quickest way to get to the next town?" The local scratched his head and he said, "Are you walking or driving?" "I'm driving," said the stranger. He said, "Well, that's the quickest way." So, enough with the humor such as it is. Some of you know that I worked for 14 years as a chaplain at Mendota Mental Health Institute. And in that time, I got to minister some of the most troubled men in the state of Wisconsin. And I learned fairly quickly that a preacher doesn't ask a rhetorical question in the midst of a sermon, or he might get answers, or at least this preacher might get answers that he didn't want. And I had students every summer, and I told them, don't ask rhetorical questions. But they knew everything. They'd been through at least 1 year of seminary, maybe 2 years, and probably had one or two preaching classes. And they were told two things: use a rhetorical question to start people thinking, and number two, never reference yourself in your sermon. Well, sermons that don't reference oneself often become pretty dry and intellectual and boring. And even the patients started to fall asleep, and that's pretty hard. But they would often ask a question such as, "Have you ever felt abandoned by God?" And all of a sudden, someone would pipe up and say, "No, because I'm the only son of God." Or, "No, because I'm too holy to ignore. But I'm going to break my rule this morning, and I'm going to ask you a rhetorical question, and you can answer it. What are the two subjects that you never talk about in a group?"
Politics and religion.
Exactly right. So that's what the general saying in our culture is: we don't talk about politics and we don't talk about religion in a group. However, our first lesson, and I had Jesse add Elijah's name in there because all of a sudden that scripture lesson starts out, "And he himself." Who in the heck is he himself? And you have no idea. Well, unless you know your Bible backward and forward and memorized every character in the book of 1 Kings, you wouldn't know that that's Elijah. And the backstory that you need to know in order to understand today's scripture lesson is that Elijah, as you may well remember, is a prophet come from God. And you may not remember the details that he came in the time of King Ahab. Now, not Ahab the Arab, the Sheik of the Burning Sands, if you remember that song from the 60s, but King Ahab, who was part of the ruling dynasty. King Ahab married Jezebel. Now, you may not have known who Jezebel was, but you may have heard that name used to refer to a woman of lesser virtue and character. So this is Jezebel, who is the wife of Ahab. And Jezebel is a Sidonite. And I'm sure all of you know who is a Sidonite, right? Another rhetorical question, and somebody might know. That's a part of Phoenicia. You may have heard of the cities of Tyre and Sidon in the scripture, part of the travels of Paul taken to Tyre and Sidon. So she was from that area of the Mediterranean, a foreigner, and they did not worship the Lord God of Israel. They worshiped a god called Baal or Baal, and I tend to pronounce it Baal, and I had a friend who said, "No, you make it sound like it's somebody's intestines." Well, it's not supposed to be. It's Baal, B-A-A-L. And this was a fertility god, And because of the marriage and being a good husband, Ahab agreed with his wife and converted the whole section of the kingdom at that time to the worship of Baal. God raised up Elijah and said, "What's happening to my people? I brought them out of the wilderness. They were to follow me. We made a covenant. What's going on? I want you to speak against this." So he goes out and speaks against it, and he gets lots of opposition, as you might expect. And so they set up a contest between the prophets of Baal and the Lord God, Yahweh, led by Elijah. They pile up two big stacks of wood. And the contest is, whose God can come down and ignite the wood? And the queen decides that it's only fair that her side should go first. So she calls upon her priests and said, "Okay, boys, have at it. Call down Baal. Have him spark this fire, this pile of wood into fire." Well, they sit around and they wait, and these guys go through rituals and incantations, all kinds of things, and the wood is as dry and untouched as the day in the beginning when they laid it down on the ground. So she says, "Okay, Elijah, let's see if you can do any better." Well, Elijah says, "Wait," he says, I need to show you that our God really is the most powerful God." And so he brings out several cisterns full of water, and they soak the wood with this water. He says, "Okay, now I'm ready." And he quietly stands there, raises his hands, as Jewish folks would be in prayer, and calls upon God to kindle the fire. And all the priests of Baal are snickering, and the queen is doubtful that this is ever going to happen, and finally she's going to have her way. And all of a sudden, kapoof! The whole pile of wet lumber explodes into flame. At that point, the queen is embarrassed because she made a deal that if they were stronger, the followers of Yahweh, than the followers of Baal, they would no longer be in power as the state religion. At that point, also, Elijah puts to the sword all the priests that are there. Well, this is kind of like adding insult to injury, and so the queen, Jezebel, is extremely upset, not only because her group didn't do what it was supposed to do, but because all of a sudden all her priests were slaughtered, and she vows vengeance on Elijah and says that by this time tomorrow he shall be dead. So that's where our story picks up. This threat has been made, and Elijah starts to flee for his life. And he is going to flee to Mount Horeb. And that's not Mount Horeb in Wisconsin. That's Mount Horeb, known as also as Mount Sinai. I've been to Mount Horeb in Wisconsin, and it's not like Mount Sinai, I can tell you. It's a nice town, but it's not a beautiful holy mountain. People there might think it is, but I didn't. So he sits outside the city under a broom tree. Now, here's another rhetorical question. How many of us know what a broom tree is? Raise your hand. I didn't either till I looked it up. And the broom tree that grows in the desert of the Holy Land literally looks like a broom that's standing on its handle. You know, like Grant Wood's picture of the farmer with the pitchfork and the pitchfork standing upright? Well, it would be like he held a broom and the head of the broom was upright. And this broom tree spreads out, and it has a narrow trunk and only foliage very much at the top that then droops a little bit. But it looks like a broom, and I can see how it got that name. But, you know, you may have read that and wondered, what's a broom tree? Now you know. So he sits under the broom tree, and he's discouraged, he's frightened, he's afraid that something's going to really bad happen to him, like he's going to lose his life. He doesn't like Jezebel. He's seen the kind of things and tricks that she's pulled in the past and doesn't put anything past her, let alone the fact that she is the queen and has commanded the king's army as well to send them out after Elijah. So here he sits under the tree in the only shade he can find. He's discouraged, frightened, and in despair. Doesn't want to go on, doesn't know what to do. Maybe you've been at that place in your life where things you thought went well for you, and all of a sudden there was a quick turnabout. People thought things differently than you thought they would, and all of a sudden you're the focus of negative attention, to say the least. So he's feeling sorry for himself, as one might. He's frightened. He's despairing about what to do next. And all of a sudden, an angel of the Lord appears to him and says, and puts out some cakes on a hot stone and produces a cistern of water and says, "Rise, take and eat, or you will not have strength for your journey." Now, as most of us, even if we were a prophet of God, we have a little question about someone who suddenly appears with food and drink for us and tells us to eat. And so this angel again repeats the message to him, "Rise and eat and drink so that you will have strength for the journey to Mount Horeb." Scripture then says he did rise, he ate and he drank, and he had strength for 40 days and 40 nights. So now I need to also share with you that that's a biblical term for a long time. If you remember throughout scriptures, many things are referred to as happening for 40 days and 40 nights. Have you ever thought that's curious, that always it was chosen for 40 days and 40 nights? What's special about 40 days and 40 nights? What's special about it is it's a Hebrew idiom, a word of speech, that means for a long time. Now, it might have taken Elijah 40 days to get to Mount Horeb, Mount Sinai, but it did take him a long time. And so being literal in this case may add to more problems than understanding it as a figure of speech. I'm going to leave Elijah there on his way to Mount Sinai, and I want to pick up where Jesus starts, where he says, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Obviously, this claim, as we heard in the scriptures that Jesse read for us, inflames the Jewish people and the leaders. They know this kid. He's just a young guy. He's the son of the carpenter Joseph, and his mother is Mary. He just hangs around here and preaches all the time. Who is he to say he is the bread of life? This is blasphemy. And then he goes on and he talks more about it, and talks about, this is, "My bread is the flesh." And they go on and engage more in their struggle with what he has to say and to tell them, taking the words literally as they are, as if somebody was going to roast Jesus and carve him up and serve him for Thanksgiving dinner. That's often the problem when we take things literally. And so the Jews of his day had that problem as well. But if we think of that in a different way, if we think back to the Sermon on the Mount or the Sermon on the Plain, depending upon which gospel you read, it's the same story and the same message. Jesus gives the beatitude there, and he says, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness." Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Here is the answer in today's gospel lesson to the questions that come up about hungering and thirsting for righteousness. Jesus feeds that hunger and that thirst by his presence, by his life, and by his teaching. For those of us, we may wonder, not as much as the Jewish folks, because we know the whole story. We know the story of Jesus' death and resurrection. We know the story of the Lord's Supper and what that was instituted for, to be bread for the journey. That is to nourish us in body and soul as we live out our faith. But then I have thought about how I see that happening in the midst of our own community. I think of how we express the love of God through food ourselves. Call it a covered dish, call it a hot dish, call it a casserole. But many of you have brought one to a friend, a neighbor, a church member, at a time where there's been a death, when there's been sickness, when there's been problems, when someone's lost their job, and when what we might say comes very hard to express. The right words never seemed, when we thought about them, in the comfort of our own home, to come out the way we want them to when we're in the presence of the bereft person. So we say something and we come forward and we offer food. For food is not only food that comes spiritually, but is food that comes physically. It is your expression of your care and your love for others. Many times I've sat downstairs in fellowship hall and I've seen the women put together a meal after a funeral. And I hear some of them talk about, oh yes, we're going to get this hot dish from so-and-so and we'll get this favorite dessert from her. And I hear so-and-so is going to bring her salad. And so for that family that gathers, your gifts of food remind them that they are in the circle of love. They are fed spiritually through their faith, and they're also fed spiritually and physically through the food that you provide for them. Many of you have come into the church office throughout the week to do some business, either with the pastor or with Jeannie. And usually, there is a box of goodies there that Jeannie has made. And Jeannie probably is not handsomely paid, but paid adequately. Yet she bakes endlessly, because literally she loves to do it and she loves the people that come in, and it's her way of expressing her love to them. Now I'm going to tell a tale that I haven't told the people that I'm going to tell it about, so I may be in trouble. So if you see two women pummeling me after church, come to my rescue, some of you. In 2017, soon after we moved to Delavan, we were working to get our street plowed, and the city, actually the town, didn't want to plow it. And I wasn't ready to go outside and stop the plow one morning when he was coming through. And Barb was more ready than I was, so I asked her to go out and to stop the plow. Well, she slipped on some boots and ran out, and the boots did not have good traction. It was icy. She fell, and she broke her right arm, her forearm. ended up going to the hospital and coming and having it set and coming home. She wasn't happy with me for me asking her to go out, and I don't blame her one bit. And she was miserable. And then the second day that we were home, the phone rang, and it was Katie. And Katie called and said, "Hey, I got a pot of soup I'm going to bring over. When can I come?" Not, "Do you want a pot of soup?" "I've got a pot of soup." Which was fine. It was a bit awkward because I didn't know what to say. And I stumbled around a bit, and I said, "Well, a little later this morning, come by." And so she did. And she brought in this delicious pot of soup, left it with us, and then said a couple things, maybe stayed all of five, no more than 10 minutes, and was on her way out the driveway. That, to me, was a personal experience of that kind of love and care that we show for one another. The same kind of love and care that God showed to the Israelites as they wandered in the wilderness. When they were there for 40 years, we don't know if it's exactly 40 years, if they wandered for whole 40 years or whether they stayed in one place for a while, but they were without food and they complained to Moses, and Moses on their behalf complained to God, and God provided them with bread, manna, and quail from heaven so that they would have enough to survive on physically and to demonstrate God's love and care for them. So it is that God shows God's love through the physical aspect of food. God did that with Elijah. God did that with Jesus in the Lord's Supper. And so you, as imitators in the best sense of the word of Jesus, do that with the task that you do when you prepare your favorite recipe or a special dish or some other nourishment for someone either in our congregation or someone that has come to us to provide them support at the time of a death. It is a gift, and it is a way for you and I to continue to be like God. May God bless us in this ministry of feeding others with love. Amen. Let us turn to our prayers. Tim Keithley still remains on our list. That's the son-in-law of, not Tammy, but what's her sister? Cheryl Davis. And I have no update on him. I talked with Van Brown this week, and he said his brother is holding his own. He's has cancer and is living in a nursing home care center right now. I don't know anything about what Erica's condition is now. Does anyone that we can share and pray more definitively about her? Okay. Jim Charles, as you know, used to be a part of our congregation, has returned home to Indiana and resides in special care. Joy Nelson remains at home, not strong enough to be at church with us. And Frank and Joanne, how's Stephen doing? Okay. Ron and Judy Marsh. Now, I've forgotten who they are. Anybody help? Okay. And? Okay. And the family of David Copeland. I don't know. Yes, Dren.
He's was the son of my good friend, Dren Copeland. He's been fighting cancer for many
Okay. Okay. Sorry to hear of that. Are there others that we wish to pray for this morning? Let us pray. O Eternal One, we've shared with one another the latest news we have about those we have listed in our bulletin. We call upon you and lift them by name before you for your blessing and your care. For the family of David as they cope with his death. Give them peace and strength in their sorrow. For all the others who are wrestling with disease and infirmity, we ask your presence especially. We ask for your comfort. And we ask for your healing. Help them all to know your presence and know the strength of your spirit. We pray for not only our nation, but for our world in continuing in the grips of COVID-19 and the many variants that are developing. We pray for the wisdom of the researchers to continue to provide resources for us to fight against this dread disease. We pray for those who are reluctant to be vaccinated. We pray that they may be protected and hopefully come to some resolution that will allow them to accept the help that's available to them. We pray for our pastor, Angel, and his family as they spend time away from work responsibilities and have fun together. May they be blessed and renewed and brought home safely to us. We also pray for Michelle and her time away. She may find enjoyment and rest and come back to us to lead us again in worship. We give you thanks for the gift of Abby to be her substitute and to lead us this morning. We pray as well for those in the armed services, those that who are affiliated with our congregation, and those men and women scattered throughout the world, working to maintain and keep peace in harm's way. Keep them safe, keep our whole world safe, and help us to battle with words rather than with bullets and bombs and missiles. Help us to find ways to settle our differences as peoples and to live in harmony and to support one another across country lines and across the seas that separate the continents. May our faith help us to be peacemakers, as Jesus has called us to be. Bless us in our individual needs that we may not have felt like sharing with everyone this morning. May we find strength and comfort and guidance from you. may we find your presence and your food, the food of your spirit, to guide us in our various journeys. For all those who have no one to pray for them yet have great need, hear our prayer this morning, that you may touch their lives and bring them a measure of comfort and hope as well. For we would make this prayer and all our prayers in the name of Jesus, our Savior, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Nourished by the bread of heaven and the living waters of salvation, let us return thanks to God as we collect today's offering. You'll find the offertory prayer on the screen or in your bulletin. Let us pray together. Bountiful God, we praise and thanksgiving for your many blessings. Receive our tithes and offerings, that they may be for the world of signs of the bread of heaven and the fullness of your grace. For we came here hungry for your spirit, and you fed us with the food that satisfies. You came here thirsty for your grace, and you revived us in our need. In humble thanks, go forth from this place and imitate the Holy One in all you do.
You will live with love, speak with kindness, touch with gentleness, walk with humbleness, and build up the kingdom of God.
Go forth into the world and live in love as Christ lived in and through you. Amen. Go in peace. Mm-hmm.